Hi everyone, it's Ms. Lopez. In this video, I'm going to go through and explain the lemur activity. This is using box plots to compare the distribution of weight in pounds of lemurs. If you have not at this point read the instructions on how to identify and build box whisker plots, you need to stop this video now and go read those instructions in your notebook. Otherwise, the stuff that I'm doing will not make any sense. So stop this video, go read those instructions in your notebook about how to make box whisker plots, and then come back and finish up this video. Okay, so the first thing we are going to do is we are going to notice that there are various lemurs listed on this table. And the way that it is, or the way that they are identified, is not only by different colors, but you can also see that the name is provided for you and that the color matches the color of the box whisker plot. So that's very helpful in visualizing and in helping in making it understandable. You'll also notice that there is a number line right down the bottom of your graph here. And when we look at box whisker plots, it really helps if you're using graph paper, because that way you can try to make your lines as straight as possible. Okay, so we're going to look at the first question. It says, which lemur species has the highest median weight? And it's going to be the Cockerel's siphaca. You can see on the graph or on the data range where the information, or where the median crosses right here, is 8.5, and none of the other medians are going to go that high. So right there on the graph where it crosses, that is the highest median, so it's the Cockerel's siphaca. Next, which species has the smallest difference between its mean weight and its lower extreme weight? That would be the mongoose lemur. The reason I know this is because when I look at the range of data, and using the squares here on the graph is going to be extremely helpful. When I look at the various data points, I'm focusing on the median down to our lower extreme. And when I compare, just kind of looking at I'm using the squares that are on this chart here to help me. And when I look at this, it looks to be about one. I'm kind of guesstimating at this point. I could just kind of go down to the graph itself and figure out what that is. But if I can kind of reduce the amount of time by not having to check all of them, it will make my response and mobility respond much faster. So if I'm just looking at the gray bars that are right here, I can see this is about one, whereas this one definitely goes over from here to here, is more than one. From here to here, you can see we cross over two of these lines, that's gonna be more than one. And then definitely for these will also be more than one. So I'm gonna pick my mongoose lemur. Next question. Which species has the largest difference between its median weight and its upper extreme weight? The answer is Cockerel's siphaca. Again, what I'm looking at is the difference between the median weight and the upper extreme weight. And to kind of make this process go a little faster for me, I'm just going to go ahead and eliminate two of these answer choices, or two of these types of lemurs. I'm going to eliminate this one here. This is definitely a small range. I'm also going to eliminate this one because although it is larger than this one, it's still only about roughly about two from my estimate. So this is a box right here. I meant two lines, sorry. So that is a range of one. So you can see that it's really not as large as this one right here. So this one spans across from about 4.7 to about 6.9. So this one is still even larger than these two. I'm going to eliminate them. What I have to do is I have to find the difference, or have to kind of figure out the range for the ringtail lemur, Cockerel's siphaca, and the red ruffed lemur. So if I can eliminate two of them right off the bat, that will help me in reducing the amount of time I'm spending on a question like this. So let's figure out what these ranges are. So when I'm looking at the ring-tailed lemur, I'm estimating somewhere between 4.6 to up to about 6.9. So that range of data is about 2.3. For the red ruffed lemur, that range is about 2.3. I estimate somewhere between 10 to 7.7 on the graph, and so that range is also 2.3. For the cockerel saffaca, I estimate somewhere between 8.5 and 11.4 is the range, making that 2.9, and that's why the cockerel saffaca has the largest difference between the median weight and its upper extreme weight. The last question asks, the next to last question, which species has a larger overall weight range, the ring-tailed lemur or the red ruffed lemur? So for this question, we are going to compare the two, and we are going to look at the range of data from the lowest lower extreme to the highest number on the upper extreme. So you can see here that this is the range of the ring-tailed lemur. And when I take the upper extreme and subtract it from that lower extreme, I'll get a numerical data. So the range for the ring-tailed lemur is about 3.6. For the red ruffed lemur, the red area shaded is the range of data. And I'm also going to take my upper extreme, the highest number in my upper extreme, and subtract it from the lowest number in my lower extreme. And that range is 4.1. So for number four, I'm going to select red ruffed lemur because its overall range is higher. The last question asks, how would you describe the weight distribution of the mongoose lemur? So for this comparison, we're going to look at each of the quartiles and kind of see if more of the numbers or if the range of the quartiles is different. And right off the bat, one of the things I can notice is that from the median to the upper extreme is already larger than the median to the lower extreme. So even without having to figure out ranges, I'm just kind of guesstimating here where those values are. So from the lower extreme, lower extreme to the lower quartile, you can see that this is a pretty small range. From the lower quartile to the medium, it's still pretty small. It's under one. And from the median to the upper quartile, it's still a value under one. But when you look at the upper quartile to the upper extreme, this is the largest value. It covers more than one set of blocks, which is equal to about one on our scale here. And so when we're looking at this data, we're looking at how spread out those quartiles are. And just looking at it without even getting quantitative data, I can see that the upper extreme range is higher or larger than any of the other quartiles. So I'm going to write that the upper extreme quartile has a larger spread than any of the other quartiles. I hope this video was helpful to you guys. Thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you next time.